So we're going to implement pagination in your in the Marketplace API. And what we need to do first is based on the design in Apiary. So in the design Apiary, I have an object. So first change, right, is I introduce two more parameters that I can allow, I can accept into get products. First thing. Second thing is the response structure has changed. So let's work on the parameters first. How do you add the parameters to the existing endpoint? So here is my get all products. Existing, we have only one query parameter, which is category. So I'm gonna add two more parameters, right? So let me just change them. So one will be page size, which is an integer type. Just change the name accordingly. Second will be page index. This is also an integer type. Right. What about the defaults? How can I specify a default here? So let me see. I think it's this default value. So in your query parameter, you can add one more annotation to your parameter. So there's this annotation called default value. Why is it not adding? It's not there, you could add the same. So make sure you import Java X WSRS dot default value. So for every parameter you use, you can actually, let's see. Yeah, specify a default value for your parameter here. Now default value accepts only, let's see, value which is a string. Okay, define is the default value of a request metadata that is bound in one of the following annotations. So you can use this for path parameter, query parameter, and the rest of these other types of parameters. Okay. Now it accepts a string. So what it does is that it actually puts a pointy there and then later converts to page size here. What about page index? We also need a default, which is based on our design, we specify 0 as a default value. So put in 0 here. Okay, so that completes the first part of adding additional parameters to handle pagination for this endpoint. So let's update the top here, right? Size. So this is a bit like documentation of what the store is there. Okay. So how do we use the parameters? Okay, for now keep it there. So you actually will use the parameters when you do the database collection part. So when you retrieve from the database, you will need these two parameters to give you the correct records in your table. So there's a certain formula to get, because when you retrieve from the database, you cannot, when you retrieve page records from the database, unfortunately, you don't actually, in MySQL, you don't actually tell the database, I want a page size of this and a page index of that. In MySQL, they only understand the language of where you want to take the records from and then how many you want to take. Okay, so that language is very different from this language here. So that's one part. Next part that we need to update would be the response. So now the response, instead of a JSON array, we have an object with attribute called list and three more attributes, one called next, previous, and total count. So in order to craft a response like this, you need to create an object or a class that defines the structure. So let's go to models. Let me add. So here you unfortunately need to create one more Java class. Let me call that product, or maybe generally pagination result. So or pagination result or page result. Let me just call this paged. So page result will give you a object that you have a list, which is the actual result, the list of items, and then with a next, previous, and total count. Since we're doing this for products, maybe let's just change it a bit. Okay. Products page result specifically. So in the product page result, I have a few properties, just like the API design. One of them is called list. Now the list, right? What type is the list? Okay. So list is consists of product model. Let's do this for now. So this is really a list that is our type. That has products inside. It also has a next, a previous, and for this case, a total count. Okay, why does it appear like this? Okay, because we use an import. Okay, do this. So that's what imports here, just to clean it up. So this will form the basis of my return object. Let's take a closer look again. So every item here consists of this few information that return from product. Not the full product information, but just a snippet of it. So let's take a look at our product class. Right? So this class here, product class, product Java, has a lot more information than I actually want to return. So I don't want to return everything because I want to return based on what I display in the app. So what I display in the app is far lesser than this. So maybe I shouldn't use this class to give the return data. So I will create another class to return, to model the data that I will return. So we call it a product summary. So the product summary class will consist of these few attributes that I need. Not everything, but just some of them. So let's key them in. So I have integer, I have the name, I have the seller. So here I can just follow as per what my design, you know, says when you return the list of products. Description. Okay, so these are the different attributes based on this return. So since I'm going to use product summary to return my data in the page, product page result, let me go back to product page result. So instead of using product, I'm going to use product, replace it with product summary. Okay. So here my objects are prepared. Next is go to my resources. So summary my resources in this method, I need to create an instance of this product page result. So product page result. Let's call them result. So create instance, and then, it's complaining that I can't find. Products, sorry, type error. Products paged results. Import it. Okay. And then set my list. So here I do some initialization. Okay. So over here, what's this error? change this to erasers. So worry about that. Okay, so we use erasers here. So here I'll do an initialize. So somewhere between this to the last line is when, let me comment on this old part here. Somewhere between this initialization to the return response is where we're going to call the database and return the result based on the parameters of page size, page index, and category. So I'm going to just describe what happened this time, right? Call database class method and populate result.js. Okay. Check if there are more records. Populate result.next. So when you call the database to say, give me the category and based on page index and page size, you also need to know whether are there more records under this or not. So if you know there are more records, then you can create, then you can set up the URL for the next. And also if page index, right, is more than 0, set the result previous URL. So as a rule of thumb, if you are more than 0, okay, then you should set the previous value here, the URL. Okay. So total count will be something that you return with the database. Okay. So this is sort of the template to begin to add on next time when you actually have the ability to get the data from the database and return it here. So that will actually make this method get all products based on category a bit more complete with pagination. So now later when we have the actual database return data, your app can actually have the infinite scrolling kind of experience for the user. Okay. So now let's look at the other endpoints. So here function to say I can post an offer to a product and I can cancel my offer to a product, right? So this part is assuming the user on a mobile app actually is viewing the details of one product and there's a button or call to action say make offer, okay? Make an offer. So when you make an offer, it actually adds the offer record or offer request to the product information, okay? But you can also, you know, resign the offer by canceling it. So how do we create this offer on the product? So first of all, of course, go back to apiary to design this particular endpoint. So for this, what you're doing is that this action involves one product rather than a list. So our context will be to base that action on one of these collections, one product resource. So when I'm looking at one product, what can I do? I can do get a detail, I can update one, or I can delete it, right? So under one product, the other action I can do now is to add an offer to it. How do I do that? So let's add one more design. So I'm going to design this feature of adding an offer to a product. So, but yeah, add offer for the product. Okay. So when I add an offer to a product, effectively I'm adding something. When I'm adding something, so we can use a post verb to describe, to actually design, to describe the action. So what am I actually doing? Okay. So when I make an offer for a product, let's see. The URL design, I would think. So let's say add an offer to a product. Products ID offer. So this is the URL that we can actually create. So what am I doing is that under the products, the ID will identify one product, and under the product, I nest a resource called offers. So, okay, there are many ways to get around adding an offer for a product. This is one method. I can also, you know, otherwise do this, which makes sense too. So between this line 134 and 2140, there are two methods to add an offer. So I'm essentially what I'm doing is that when I make an offer, I'm adding a record that specifies, oh, buyer ID this makes an offer for product ID this. Okay, so that's the identification or the relation. So you can either look at offers as a resource standing alone by itself like that, offers. So just like treat it like product, just post something in the offers and then treat it as a whole thing. Or you can say, I want the offers, the way to access the offers to be specific to the product ID by itself. So I use the first part of the URL, which is products, followed by the unique identifier or the ID, then slash offers. So this is a bit like your folders, when you have subfolder in the main big folder. So you know that, oh, when I look for this particular folder called offers, it's in fact this product with the ID. So let's say I go with this first approach to allow offers to be created under this URL. So buyer say add offer for product. Then of course, because you're doing an add, adding something to the resource, then you use a post. Then of course, if you're doing a post, the rest of the request structure and all that is quite standard. So like when you, so now you start to think about if I am a buyer, I make an offer or product, what kind of information will be sent to the Android app? Or what kind of information do you want to keep? So importantly, when a person makes an offer on a product, you want to have able to link it back to the user who did it. So most likely you probably have a buyer ID. So you need to know who made an offer. First of all, who made an offer, so buyer ID is needed. Okay, and then you also need to know, maybe the date and time. Okay, or maybe not. So let's think of the information. I need to know who, when, what. Okay, what the offer, what is the person doing. So the who, you have buyer ID. So that will be taken from whoever the buyer is logged into the app. When, date and time, you can either take it from the Android application, or you can use the server time to store the data. So first part, think about what you need to collect. Then the second part, think about what you need to store in your database. Because if you don't store it, then the system cannot, there's no way the buyer can retrieve their offers, right? Or seller will inform that they have an offer. Okay. What are they offering on? Well, the what is easy to answer because your what actually is contained in the URL as a path parameter, the ID of the product. So if let's say I go with the strategy of, okay, I only need to know the buyer ID, who offered. System, the date and time, I don't need to get it from the Android app, I get it from the server. So I know who, I know what they want to offer on, than the time I get from the server. So only information I need from Android app is the user or the buyer who say I made offer on the product. Okay. Any other possible information that you might want to collect? Maybe price. You know, Carousell lets you offer, right? And then there's a price there. So maybe your Android app allows the buyer to specify a price. So it's an open market, right? Maybe a person sells for $50, sell the item for $50, but then the buyer decided that it's not worth $50. So you can offer alternate price. So price may be another value that, you know, the person can key in. So who, what, offer, how much, price. So from the user as a buyer perspective in the Android application, when I make an offer, because Android knows who I am, the ID be sent over. But when I make an offer, maybe I can key in the price that offer the product, offer to buy the item for. So that's the only other input needed. That's it. So in your design, you will have other inputs you need from the buyer or the user in the Android app. You need to include it inside here. Anybody think of any other inputs you need from a buyer? Or do you think this is enough to know about a buyer who makes an offer for product? Anyone got any comments? No comments, huh? Sorry? Meetup. Oh, meetup location. Can also, that means you want the buyer can specify, I want to do a meetup where. Right. Okay. So maybe you can add in meetup location. If you specify meetup location, maybe you want to specify when? East, West, North, South. Region, area. Oh, it's an under meetup location, it's an area, is it? Can also. So, I guess it can be up to what you want to add in here. So, why are you going through this thinking process about this information that you want to send in? So a lot of your web services design in terms of the data you want to record is heavily dependent on what your app looks like, especially on that screen that uses this API. So if your screen is going to let the person define meetup location, where, which area, meetup timing, and any other like even a remarks field to send a message, right? You have to take account that you're going to send all this into your web service and eventually go into the database somewhere. So this is free play up to how you create. If your interface has certain fields you want to keep, then you will change the way or the data that you need to send in the API or your request body. Okay. So let's say this is a few things I want to send in the request. Okay, so I'm done. What about my response? If I were to send an offer, what do you think? So the Android app will say, okay, now I let the buyer send in the offer. Now do I need a response from the server to tell the buyer something like a message, or your offer has been successfully sent, or the kind of thing. So to acknowledge that a successful request or offer has been made. So of course you need to include the response and rightfully the code for it. So most of the time in theory we will assume a successful situation and you will return perhaps something. What we want to return, other than telling the user that your offer was successfully sent in and recorded, maybe you want to send into the Android app the ID of the offer, some way for the user to go and find my list of offers. So you could possibly return the ID of offer so the user can actually retrieve it. Or you can also make use of a technique that we just used in pagination. So let's say I need an offer on this, and yeah. So you can also return back a URL for the app to easily go back to the detail of this offer made. This is to signify that your offer has been successfully created in the database and the offer ID is here. So this is another way to keep a certain response. Because some students also like to include a message. So even things like that, you can actually customize and include in response. So it's really up to how you want to design this. So let's say this is the way I've done it. Let me save my documentation. Sorry. So now I have product resource. I have an offer to a product. So buyer and offer for product, click on that. This is the URL to post to this. Okay. And here's the body. I think I'm missing here the ID. Let me go back to the editor. So I also have parameters. In this case, I have the parameter of the product. Let me come back to this. So in this, this web service, what I've allowed the client application to do is to make an offer for a product. There's a parameter for ID of the product, as well as the request body, the information of the buyer, price, and maybe like example me a location. Okay, so assuming this is a design for make an offer, how do I implement? So in this case, it's a bit different. I have an offers here, which is nested under products. So we make it very clear that offers exist as a kind of a resource, but not under products. Where should we place offers in? Okay, if you were to place inside products, there's nothing very wrong about it, except that your products Java will have a mixture of other things there. So I would say the best way, or the ideally what's easier to maintain or to maintain and separate all the code is to create a new class for offers. So this is the offers resource. So I'm gonna try a few ways to do this one. So in JavaJC, what I can do is I can create a class of offers and embed it in the products if I want to. Okay. So just take a look at the collection. So nothing nested collections. Okay, let me look for sub resources. This is right, sub resources. Okay, sub resource methods. Okay, so what are sub resources? The one that I'm trying to do when we put an offer inside product, that's called a sub resource. Let me show you. So here is printer. This is a printer resource example. And these are all the methods in printer resource. So we're going to create a sub resource basically under item. Okay, I have a content here. So item is the main resource and content is a sub resource. So there's a get item resource content. So this item content resource comes from another class. So this allows you to put part of sub resource called content under item. So likewise for offers, we will need to create first of all the offer class. So at this point you need to decide, can offers be regarded as a main resource? Because you notice that under the item content resource, there's no path defined there. Right? But this can be part in there. So let's try this. So let me just create offers. For now, I don't think offers will be offered as a under the API service / offers. Okay, so this will be a sub resource. Let me just make it look. Products. So the offer cannot exist unless it belongs to a particular product. So I'm going to create an offer, but at the same time, this offer resource will have an add. So let me create a response, add offer. So this part of the coding really looks just like any other thing that you've done so far in the previous example. Okay, so I have a the method, I still also need to define what's the HTTP method that I'm using. So this will be a, post. I'm doing a post, alpha. Post. So I'm using a post for this. And of course, there is an object to create. So let me set up this part first. Okay. This will also take consume application JSON. So you add it later. So now I created a basic setup for offers with one method, add offer. Haven't defined a parameter and response return type yet. So I go back to Java, product Java, and then I add in under product ID. So here I'm going to return offers. Offers resource. So basically what I'm doing is return new offers. And for this one I'll do a get path. This will have a path. ID offers. Okay. Yeah, this should be kind of stuff. Okay, so fairly straightforward. So what happened here, okay, is that inside my products, I create a path to this ID / offers. And then the type of return is the offers object, which is here. This is offer resource. And I return a new instance of that. Try to compile this in the class, we can test this particular method out. Okay, so missing here is the ID, because I have ID in the path, right? We'll talk about how to pass the ID inside offers. Okay, how do I... Oh. Now I got a red cross here. Let's see. So far, do you all understand why I put the offer inside here? Or how it works? Yes? No? No, no. I think I need to restart my Eclipse. But do you understand the rationale why I would design the endpoint for buy and offer like this? I can't start my server. I think my glassfish disappeared. How many of you are able to follow so far on adding the offer resource? Yes. I have lost. Go back to the designer. As a buyer, I can post an offer to a product. Put on Notepad. So as a buyer, I can post an offer to a product. So step one in designing the web service to handle this request is know what is your interface. So for a moment, think about what you have in the interface that allows a user to post an offer for a product. So step one. Let me try this because I'm looking at the web version of Carousel. I'm gonna convert Carousel to a So this Carousel here, version of Carousel, is the web mobile responsive version of Carousel, which resembles closely to how the mobile app looks like. So in this mobile app or Carousel, what happens is that there's a search bar on top. Okay. There's also the categories, subcategories under electronics, and the list of items here. So as I scroll down, I'm gonna continue scrolling to look for the next button. Okay. Done, no more. Realize that there is no next previous here. So what's been happening, so I'll open the network first. So interestingly, as I scroll down, let me go back at the top. So let's just restart from the top. So when I launch the site and enter the Carousel page under electronic, it shows me a list of items. Let me clear this. Let me look at this and clear this out. Okay. So the network activity, I'm gonna capture some network activity that happens and scroll downwards. Okay. So interestingly, as I scroll down, there's some network activity happening. So it's a calling server to retrieve information of some sort. And some more information, some more images, and some of this information, some scripts. Scroll some more. So as I scroll down, it starts to get more information from Carousel APIs, whether it's images or some more content of all kinds. Okay, so let's go to one item detail. So the one we're going to look at is what happens when I want to offer on something. So let's say I click on this. So this is a product detail, make an offer, right? So when I click on make an offer, the screen actually gives me options. Say that, this seller is offering this product for this amount, you are offering how much? So you can actually change the amount here. And then click on make an offer. So in the mobile experience, what happened, you can actually do something similar to say that, these are some fields I want the user to key in. and then press the button, then I send the request over. So like our case when we did the design for API, we have buyer ID, price, meal location, or rather there are four information. One is product ID, what item am I offering, who is it, the price, and meal location. Among these four pieces of information, two of them are already known, and two of them you want the user to key in. The two that you know is the ID, which is the product ID identifier, the user, which is the buyer ID, but the one you need the user key in will be the price and meal location. These two fields will appear somewhere here as two text boxes. So if you were to create the Android app for this screen, the activity screen, you'll probably have the picture, information about the product and the seller, what the seller's price is, and then two text boxes to key in the price and maybe near location for this design. And then finally a button to send the offer. And where would that data be sent to? So in this current design, we're going to send it to this URL, product offers. And how do we create a offers, like another path nested inside products? Is to create a thing called a sub-resource. So a sub-resource in the Java code I show you is how we create, is almost like creating another resource, but you embed it inside the main resource of this product here. Let me update the code. Error during deployment, keys can be linkage error. Huh? Is there something to do with this? Hold on, so you complain that keys cannot be duplicated. What do I mean? Say what that means. Okay, one of those weird days. Okay, let's go and check. So this one you never seen before, right? See server log for details. Okay, so if you get an error message like this and it tells you to look at your server log for details in case you don't understand what has been described here. Server logs can be accessed in GustFish console. Go to monitoring data and then there's an instance here. So under monitoring data instance GrassFish, you can see the server logs. So one of them will be here, view log files. Okay, so this is a log viewer, which tells you three kinds of information. The log level. The log level shows you info is the most mundane type. So it's just information, nothing that you can really care about or be attention to. What you want to be pay attention, what you want to pay attention will be the one that says severe. Okay. Severe actually means like errors in general. Okay. So you click on severe, you can see okay, these are the stuff that happened. And just now what I got the message was key cannot be duplicate. So it looks like this guy. Right? So I'm trying to find out why they say key cannot be duplicate. Illegal argument exception. Okay. Okay, so bad news is I don't understand what this error means as well. Okay. Yeah, seriously don't understand what this error means. Set me. Oh. Okay, so I have no clue what it means. Attempted to break class information for GDBC information. Instance of GrassFish web loader attempted. Okay, so I'm gonna do what most people I know would do when I get this kind of thing. Google it. Okay. So when an error comes out that I don't understand, there's only two things I will do. Go to Google, find information that someone actually solved the problem, and then get a solution. Or revert what I did. So when I mean reverting what I did is to literally do a U-turn on a few things. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take away the app here. So I'm guessing has the error got to do with something that I just added, which is these few classes, product page, product summary, okay, or offers like Java. So let's try offers like Java. So let's keep this class here. Maybe what I'll do is I'll create a class. Actually, I don't need to. Maybe what I'll do is I'll just take away the method inside, so it's empty class. And then in my products, so I'm gonna take away bit by bit items and try and see if actually the error comes from there. Okay, probably not. Next thing is to remove this. That. What other things will I remove? Yeah, probably remove this one as well. So this is what I'm trying to do, is to revert to the last working state. So I remove as much things as much as possible so that it looks like mostly what the original code was. That still doesn't work. definitely not good. Like Java. So I'm gonna take out this one. Okay. Keys cannot be duplicated. What keys? Let's say I take away the office job and see what happens. Still. So going to, here's the worst thing I can do lah. Complete undo. Of course, I want to keep my so I'm gonna do a complete undo reset. Take away, delete this, and this. Okay, so my products Java is as per original. I'll take away this one. Because remember the last yesterday we had this working, so I'm gonna do a clean and just try and see if this still works. Okay, still can't work. So if this doesn't work, means there's something else wrong with my clips. Let's restart. Whether API works. Let's try marketplace again. Oh, marketplace API works. Start. Okay. Try some of the endpoints. Okay, that's working. Yeah. So I need to revert my changes again. Okay. Let's do put a summary first. For page result, okay. Now I go to products. In page size, the value 20. Okay. And then adding the other is page index. So I'm going to revert the code anyway. Products page result. Just create this instance, see what happens. No errors. Modify this. Turn this on instead. No errors. Okay. And create the offers resource. Okay. Add in this. No errors. Site offers add this in. I have parking meter turn new offers. Okay. Working. So let's try to call my. Okay, so I added back the offer sub resource to get one product. So I'm going to duplicate this tab. Now I end offers here. Post. Post and offer. Oh, yes. Okay, should I have changed? Get one product. Turn it. Okay. Okay, so I'll change this request to do a product. So this is a product ID, and with the offers, I'm going to do a post. Not found. Ah, because I missed some up. Okay. Okay, so back to normal now. So going back to what I trying to finish is to add a offers sub resource to products. So this is product resource, but my actual code for doing a post to offer is inside offers.java here. So this method will handle a post to offers. But I don't want to expose offer as a resource at the root, meaning if I don't want to call it like this. So instead of doing a post to offers at this URL, where I need to give like the product ID, buy ID, all the information, I decided to do a post to this URL instead. So to do this, it's a little different from creating another resource. So just at the same set of creating another resource called offers, I have the class, I have the method to handle it. Except for this case, the offer doesn't have a path. So it doesn't exist at the root. But instead, I create this class, I go to the products, which is the parent resource I want to put offer inside. And then I create a method that returns an offer class and park it under this path. So when the request says, oh, you're looking for product ID slash offers, it gets this method. And then I can, based on this, I'm going to return a new offer class, which is this object. And then it happens to check, oh, I'm doing a post. Then Java will identify that post request to this particular method. Now, if I were to do something like a get, okay, what happens here if I do a get? Get product ID 33 offers. So this literally means give me all the offers made for this product. And throw it to send, right? You tell me 4 or 5 method not allowed. That's because there isn't a method under offer that returns a get. Get it so far? So because there's no get method here for offers, basically for this path, it only has a post, doesn't have a get. So if I try to do a get request, you tell me that method is not allowed. Because the only one thing you can find is a post. Now if I do want to return a handle a get, I simply need to code to offers and say, okay, now I want to handle get offers. So I just need to add one more method here. Change this one. So when I add a method here in offers to say get offers, okay. And I just need to publish. Go to this again. Then this will work. So you see that if I have, as long as I have a matching method for that class, even for sub resource, it will be able to work. If I don't have it, then it will give me either 4 not found or method not allowed. So the same rules apply at sub resources. As it applies for the main resource. So this is useful if you want to have a way to segregate like nested resources for a parent resource, if you don't want to put it at the root. Okay so far? Yeah. Okay, so now the next thing is this. So the assumption or the fact that we established is that every offer needs to be tied to a product. So there's no such thing as an offer that has no product tied to it, right? So that means every product needs a product ID. So going back to product Java, because every offer must have a product ID, I'm going to capture the path parameter ID here. and send it into offers. Okay, right now it's underline rate because in my offer constructor, I don't have, in my offers or Java, I don't have a constructor that actually handles the ID. So what is this ID here for the ID? So when the constructor allows me to set the ID, so when I do this, what I'm doing is I'm creating a constructor for offers that accept a product ID, which means that every time anything else I do inside here to say add offer, get offer, or update anything, it has to have, I'll need to use this product ID for subsequent action. So here is call offers DB to send offer information. So by doing this, let me put, so this is a post offer for, I'm going to add the product ID inside. So now if I do a post offer, because this doesn't work, just save this. So when offer, the offer Java gets the request, handles a request to say post offer into product ID 3333. I'm able to pass ID into offer.java and then from there I do my own handling. So this one will be useful when the part when I actually receive an object I need to save in the database. I need to know what's the product that offer has been made for. Then can use this ID that's already been created when this card is instantiated. So the last thing here I need to complete for offer based on the design is this. So the body here that I need to send in the JSON has buy ID, price, and mail location. So buy ID will be coming from the Android application because it's based on the user that's logged in. Price will be based on what the user key in as well as mail location. So to have this object, I'll need to create inside the models a class for creating a new offer. So this will be a quick create offer. So the fields I need will be buyer ID. Price. And then meetup location. So this will be the JSON object I want to receive inside where? Here, add offer. Let me just maybe print out some information about. Okay, so it means it'll be good enough. So when I create the offer, add offer, I want to accept the object, which is application JSON. So I will need to update the code, not in product Java, although it's nested under product, but inside offer Java. So here, I will set up the data type that consumes. Okay. And then add the parameter for new offer. So when that is done, I can publish this. Go to Postman. So here in Postman, when I test this URL or this endpoint, I'll change the body to raw. So here I will include the fields by ID, maybe, okay, so just give a value first because it's something that the Android app will provide. price. Application. Let's do a send. So you can see when I get the values, I can actually print out the price that was sent in the request. So in a way when you implement this, it's quite clean. Is you can nest logically offers under a product ID, but you don't need to mix up the code inside product Java. You still keep your code for offers inside offer.java. So it's cleanly separate your logic for updating product data in the web service interface and your offer data in the web service interface. So in the future, when I make updates and say I want to create more methods to handle offers for a particular product ID, I just need to go to offer Java and update it instead of going to product Java. Even though the URL looks like offer is nested under products. So the only connection between the two will be this line here when if the URL matches the ID slash offers, then I will return the offers object from offers Java here. And this is how you do sub-resource or resource nesting. Okay. Any questions on? So with this method, you can actually nest as many things as you want, as long as it's logical to how you want to organize your web services. So for example, we have we also have one more nested opportunity to nest one more item here. Okay. So number 9, I can start a chat. So if you logically think about, let's say I want to group a chat, tie a chat to a product, you can do the same method here to say put a chat under product, just like put offers under product. So this is also another way of, another machine to nest something. You can nest as much as you want. You can even nest, let's say your chat is nested to a product, nested to an offer. You can also do that level of nesting if it's logical to you. So if you want to do number 9, it's very similar to how you would do number 2. Okay. So now if you want to do number 3, which is cancel my offer. Okay, so since you can actually post an offer to a product, now of course the whole range of operations can follow, like you want to get a list of offers for product, you can do that. Or you want to cancel the offer to a product, you can either think of it as a delete or maybe a put request, then changing the status of offer from something like active to archive. So regarding how you can do a cancellation, you can use a various few methods to it, like maybe you could do either delete or update. Any questions so far? Do you manage to write the offers Java inside your simple? No. Okay. So if you want to try, you can maybe catch up with this part on writing the offers Java and inserting it into your product Java. And then you can wonder, maybe you can try to add in the method for cancel offer. Anyone unclear? How you might want to write the method for cancel offer here? Okay, have a 15 minutes break.